Hi everyone, so I want to continue now talking about the trend in ionization energy, and you should notice that I spent quite a bit of time talking about ionization energy, and now I'm going to talk about the exception to a couple of the elements that to the trend in ionization energy. And the reason I spent so much time talking about it is because I want you to get the kind of concept here of explaining the trend and as well as the exception. And really what we're relying on, as I said from the beginning, is our understanding of this equation, which is the equation of the binding energy of the electron to the nucleus. Okay, but if you can explain what's going on with this equation with respect to Z effective and N, then you should be able to explain pretty much, you know, the majority of the cases of trend and exception. So right now what we're going to do is we're going to go into the exception to trend in the ionization energy. So what we'll do is just kind of go back to this plot here, which is the plot of the trend in ionization energy, and point out a couple of the exceptions here and try to rationalize why those exceptions exist. The first exception you notice, and I mentioned this when I was pointing out the trend, was that in period 2, when we see this increasing trend as you go from the left to the right side of the period, but you also notice a couple of things that violate that trend. And the first one is this beryllium versus boron violation. Okay, as we know, the trend should go up, so in other words, from beryllium to boron we should get an increase, not a decrease. The question then is, why is there a decrease instead of an increase? When you want to answer a question like this, what you have to look at is always, what is the electron configuration of beryllium and boron, and what specifically makes the electron in boron in this case easier to remove, to ionize, in comparison to the electron in beryllium. Okay, and you have to rationalize it again based on your understanding of Z effective, principal quantum number, shielding and penetration. You know, combine those, all those factors together, and think about what is the most reasonable explanation that you can come up with to explain this particular exception to the trend. So let's look at the explanation that we have here for boron versus beryllium. So boron is bigger. We expect the ionization energy to be higher, but it's actually instead smaller. So why? Well, first thing, like I said, is look at electron configuration. So boron, 5 electrons, looks like this. Beryllium, 4 electrons, looks like this. What's the main difference? The main difference is in boron, the first ionization energy corresponds to the removal of a 2p electron. In beryllium, the removal of a 2s electrons. Now, as we talked about when we talked about the energy of electrons and orbitals, I said there that the 2p orbital is less stable than the 2s orbital. And the reason for that is because of electron penetration. The 2s orbital is able to penetrate, remember, to the 1s space, whereas the 2p electron cannot, and as a result, the 2s orbital becomes more stable. Now, if the 2s electron is more stable, then to remove it would require a higher energy in comparison to the 2p electron. And that's why we see, instead of a increase here, we see a decrease, because the boron, the 2p electron in boron, is actually easier to remove in comparison to the 2s electron in beryllium. Now, you might argue that there's an increase in Z, in the atomic number, going from beryllium to boron, going from 4 to 5, and wouldn't that then make a difference in terms of the stability of the boron versus the beryllium electron? Well, as it turns out, we see that the exception exists, so clearly there is that increase in atomic number, but that atomic number increase apparently is not enough to make a difference in terms of the stability of the boron. Instead, the difference in the stability of the s versus the p orbital dominates, or it's a larger difference in comparison to the increase that you gain from an increase in the atomic number. And this is a really important point to make at this point, because when you're rationalizing these exceptions, you almost always have two factors that might go against each other, okay? And when that happens, you have to basically make a, you know, without access to actual numbers and, you know, calculations, what we have to rely on is the experimental observation. And if the experimental observation tells us one thing, then what we have to do is say the theory has to explain what we observe experimentally. So in this case, we have to conclude that the increase in Z in the atomic number going from 4 to 5 somehow doesn't compensate for the difference in stability between the 2p versus the 2s electrons, so you'll still see that decrease in ionization energy. Okay, so that's something you need to keep in mind, because like I said, there's always two competing factors a lot of times, and one factor will predict one way and the other factor will predict the other way. The question is which one is, you know, more important in that particular context, which one is the larger one. Okay, and that's something you need to start to develop the skill of being able to understand, that even though there are many, many factors that might affect something, one or two factors usually are more dominant and therefore more important than the rest of them. Let's take a look at the second exception here, which is the exception that we observe when we go from nitrogen to oxygen. Again, we expect an increase in ionization energy, but what we see is a decrease in ionization energy between N to O. What you can do at this point is you can pause the video and start to think about it on your own and think about how you can explain this exception. And what I would start with again is electron configuration, because that's really the basis of how we're going to explain all of these things, is start with electron configuration. And if I go and draw the electron configuration, and again, in this particular case, I'm actually using the box diagram because I want to highlight certain things about the electron configuration in the box diagram that I can't do with the written form. You notice that nitrogen has 7 electrons, oxygen has 8 electrons. So nitrogen looks like this, oxygen looks like this. What's the main difference? Again, what you notice here is actually they both have valence electrons in the 2s and the 2p orbitals. Okay, so from that perspective, there's no difference. The difference though exists when you look at where those valence electrons are located with respect to each other. In nitrogen, the 3 valence electrons in the p orbitals are located in one orbital each, 2px, 2py, and 2pz. In the oxygen atom, you notice that because there's 4, there's an additional electron in the oxygen atom versus the nitrogen atom. That 4th electron is actually located in one of the p orbitals that already has one electron in them. And as a result, when you put 2 electrons in the same orbital, they're both the same charge, so we know from electrostatic theory that they're going to repel against each other. And that repulsion, if you think about it, will make this electron, one of these 2 electrons, easier to remove than an electron that is only single, because there's a little bit of repulsion which makes the electron less stable in comparison to an electron that is single. And if the repulsion makes the electron less stable, that means the electron is easier to ionize. If it's easier to ionize, then its ionization energy will actually drop instead of increase. And that, in fact, is what we observe here. We see a drop in ionization energy instead of an increase. And again, you can make the argument, as I said before with boron and beryllium, that isn't there an increase in atomic number between 7 to 8? And it's true, you have more protons here. But however, somehow that increase in proton doesn't compensate for this difference in the repulsion that you gain when you get that oxygen. And you notice actually, if you look at both of these drop here, they're not big drops, right? There's a drop in energy here, but that change, that drop, is much smaller than the increase you observe when you go from one element to the other one. So in fact, the Z, or the atomic number, does make a difference. It does increase, it does make it harder for you to remove that electron. However, you have this conflicting or opposite effect coming in from the repulsion. And in this case, again, as I mentioned earlier, the repulsion actually dominates or is more important or has a larger effect. And as a result, overall, the total effect results in the decrease in ionization energy as opposed to an increase in ionization energy. We're done with discussing ionization energy, both the trend and the exception. But again, as I started with this video, I want to remind you again, the next couple of trends that I talked about, I would sort of go through them rather quickly than what I've done with the ionization energy. And the reason is because I really spend quite a bit of time on the ionization energy because I want you to use the same reasoning I use for explaining the trend, explaining the exception on these other trends that I'm going to talk about in other videos, in the upcoming videos. And I hope you get a feel for what it is that's important when we're trying to look for explanation in periodic trends. And again, that is, what is the effect on the trend on this equation right here, particularly on the Z effective value and on the N value.